Good evening and welcome to CanHammer, your stop for 40K from the Great White North. Today's show is episode 84. It's a primarily 40K show with a teeny tiny bit of AOS corrections from the previous episode. Our topic for today is how to choose an army. In addition to that, we're skipping the lore review for this bi-weekly show. And we're also going to do a Blood Angels Pimp My List for you guys out there. As usual, I am Chris, at CanHammer Chris on Twitter and Instagram, and I'm joined by my co-host, Mr.
Logan. That's at OnePlusLogan on Twitter.
And we have a special guest joining you. It's his first time on the air, Mr.
Darren. I'm not actually on Twitter, but can be remedied if necessary.
We'll get you there.
Yeah, Twitter at one point in time was the ultimate Warhammer picture exchange, and I think Instagram's starting to take over.
Oh, Twitter's still good, man. There's a lot of people on there. Like, I follow a ton of people. A ton of people follow me. It's good for staying in the loop. I'm too old for Instagram to make sense to me. I think that's the other problem.
That's not the bad one. Snapchat's
Snapchat.
The one
that I don't get Snapchat, man.
I don't get that one either.
I couldn't even figure it out. So our website is oneplusarmor.com. If you're tuning in for the very first time, this is a bi-weekly podcast that we do. We are based in Ontario, Canada. This is we basically tell you the topic of the show before we do it, so that if you're not interested, you can come to the next episode if we, you know, change games and things like that. If you're listening on iTunes, which is primary, like most of our listeners, then you'll be getting this on the Thursday after we record. And if you have Twitch TV, which is an awesome streaming service, you can join us Tuesdays live. We try to tweet it out. We should get a little bit better with our schedules and let you guys know a little bit more in advance. And hopefully that'll help our Twitch stream get a bit more popular. So the first thing we do, since Darren is new to the show, we're going to, you know, so how'd you get in the hobby, Darren? What armies do you play? And tell us a little bit about yourself.
Yeah, so I'm probably a bit older than I look. I actually started playing Warhammer in grade 9, which was approximately, oh dear, probably 1991, 92. I think that was probably like the very first edition of Warhammer. I went to a friend's house a couple of months ago, and he showed me his old rule book that he still had in his basement. Yeah. And yep. I've compared it to online images, so I think it was the first edition.
It would still be Rogue Trader in 91, I think.
Yeah, it had the dreadnoughts with like the weird like robotic arms, and it was all lead. You know, they hadn't figured out it was toxic yet, and so that's when I first picked up Warhammer, and we bought the big starter set that you could get back then with all the orcs and all the marines in it, and we basically tried to paint that really horribly, and we played maybe 2 games with it. But when you're in grade 9, you can't have an organized game. And then some members of our club started to use the old 5-finger discount at GW stores, and we got banned, and then everybody stopped playing. So plus it's kind of expensive to play in high school. It's not any cheaper back then than it is now. It's just sort of gone up with inflation, and so then I had this massive gap, and I just started playing again last year, basically.
Yep.
It was a mini wargaming bat rep that I just happened to come across at work one day, and that was like, oh, gee, now I got the means to play this.
Yeah, I get suckered back in.
Yeah, I've been taking up all my other high school hobbies again, so why not Warhammer? And that was it.
Nice.
Yeah, that's how it normally goes, right? You get out of it. But that's funny, because you started playing, I was 5 years old, so.
Yeah.
But it's funny, because like, I was like, oh, grade 9, that's when I started playing in my first tournaments. Oh, well.
So, I'm pretty old, I guess, in that way.
So what's your primary army, or what armies do you like to play? What's your favorite one?
So even in my very short career, it's fluctuated a lot. I've settled on mainly Space Wolves and Dark Angels because they seem to go well together.
Which is weird. Yeah. We were just talking about that before the show, how they should never be together.
But I do like them as individual armies as well. So, you know, I'm at the moment, I'm not a hardcore sort of, you know, Death Star player. So I'm just playing them individually, and they're super fun to play. Sprinkle in some Grey Knights and Inquisition in there, but I think I'm mostly sort of Dark Angels and Space Wolves at the moment.
Nice.
Yeah.
So would you consider yourself gamer, hobbyist, somewhere in between, fluff bunny? Like, where on the spectrum do you kind of fall in?
I'm definitely gamer. I like the game for the game. I like the fluff in my off time when I don't have to read medical books. It's entertaining. I'm definitely not a hobbyist. You don't want me painting anything.
Basically. Darren can show off our painting services, by
the way. I'm more than happy to show off other people's painting talent. I might dabble in it again as time goes on, but I doubt I could make anything look half decent. And so I'm mostly gamer / fluffy and hopefully getting into some tournament play.
So by fluff, have you read any of the novels, or is it mainly Codex book fluff, or what do you mean by fluff?
I've read every Heresy book up to whatever's most recent. I've read all the Beast Arises series, which is a really good series, by the way. If you
okay, like, I heard that, and I've been waiting to pick it up. Yeah,
it's really good. I do read the fluff sections of the books that I own. So, yeah, I think it's really interesting. That kind of what I mean. We can talk about it later, but that's kind of what drew me to these armies that I picked. You know,
cool.
That's really cool, yeah. Well, maybe not the Dark Angels, because their Horus Heresy books are... Yeah. I really enjoyed them, but I know they were... If you're not a diehard fan, they're kind of hard to swallow.
There was that good series of... That trilogy about the Dark Angels, though. But it's like 40K, not Heresy era. But that was really good, too.
Right on. So I guess we're going to go on to our hobby showcase. What we've been doing in the hobby the last few weeks. For Darren, it would be, I guess... Not, as he says, he doesn't hobby, but we'll still... get into that. So I'll start this week. I don't normally start, but I painted two War Punters. If you follow me on Twitter, you saw pictures of those. So everybody's like, oh, why are you painting Eldar, man? You're not even playing in any tournaments till like September. And it turns out that when you have 4,000 points of Eldar and you put it on a group chat, hey man, anybody can play with my Eldar that wants to, all your friends borrow your Eldar, and then you end up painting some stuff for them. So I'm actually painting 16 Warp Spiders, a Farseer on a jet bike, and two War Punters for other people to use in tournaments. So yeah, it's pretty good.
We got two people at Bloodbath that are running Chris's armies.
It'll actually be three.
Three, oh, that's
three
right.
People are using my armies, yeah.
How many Warp Spiders have you painted in your entire career?
Oh, God.
62. I would like to do 90 so that I could do both sides of a doubles army that's really filthy. But
there was talk of that for our doubles.
Yeah, there is talk of that because you've been replaced. So so that's what I've been doing. I've been also just fixing up some old demon models to get my demon army up and running. I've been running through some really cool demon lists and using the ETC as an excuse to kind of copy people's lists and look around at what's really good. I've settled on the German ETC players list, modified. So
he was running the Fiends and Screamers?
No, he was running the Khorne Hounds. So it's eight units of Khorne Hounds, a Herald of Khorne. And then he ran Kairos Fateweaver and then a second Lord of Change.
Okay.
And the second Lord of Change is the really big deal with that list because he gives him the robe. So he basically has a 3+ invulnerable save, rerolling one. He's toughness 6, so he can't be instant killed, of course.
Yep.
You give him an exalted gift because all of the results on that are really good when you have a really survivable character, like Rage and Rampage, as well as coming back when he dies. Healing wounds and summoning units when he kills guys is really good on that guy because he's very hard to kill. And then you give him the lesser gift because the Staff of Change is +2 strength.
Yeah, super
so
good.
You now have a strength 8 Lord of Change that could have rage, could come back with a 3+ invulnerable save, reroll in ones, toughness 6. Just going straight into stuff is a level 3.
Beast.
Yeah, so I had actually thought, it's funny because I had three demon lists that I've been working on because I don't know if everybody knows me, I just buy everything when I play an army. I just buy it all so that I can just play anything because I just actually bought 9 chariots of the Zinch Flaming Chariots for the models on them,
which by the way, pro tip for anyone listening, that is like the best value kit that GW has ever released. It's 2 Screamers, 3 Pink Horrors, a Herald with a disc, and an, 2 normal Flamers or something. Like
it's an exalted Flamer, 2 Screamers, 2 blue horrors, but of course you can just paint them pink and use them as pink horrors because blue horrors only exist in AOS. And then it's a Herald on a disc or it's a Herald on foot, an exalted flint. Like, so it's like,
yeah, it's like a $50 kit with over $120 worth of models. It's super good.
You know, you can go to Meeple Mart and get a discount. Yep. If you go up to like your store, like a local gaming store, and you say, I want 9 of these, maybe he'll give you like 10-20% off. But so I've been doing that. And it's funny because all three of my lists almost exactly were represented at ETC. So I was like, oh, I'm actually onto something because mine are a little bit weird. Like I really push the mask a lot in a lot of my lists.
Yeah.
and she showed up a lot there. But that's the one that I've settled on, is I need is that double Lord of Change. And then, but he took a unit of 10 horrors with 4 heralds in it, level 2, as like a summoning bunker.
Wow.
And I've decided that I would prefer 6 screamers and 2 heralds on disc instead for mobility and
ITC. Mobility and durability and whatnot. Yeah, it makes sense for ITC.
So, but that Lord of Change is a top tip. It's something that we missed when we did our demon review, but it's for the price point, he's a bargain for what you get.
Yeah, Lord of Change is really good.
Yeah. So that's what I've been up to, so I'll hand it off to you, Logan.
All right, so I'm always a big fan of Proxy Before You Buy, so I played a couple games with the new Munitorum Armored Crates to go with my Tau. Uh-huh. Shoutouts to Val for bringing that up in our chat a couple episodes ago. Those things are filthy.
Yeah.
They are filthy. Suddenly, you know, being Ballistic Skill 4 isn't so bad when you're rerolling ones, and Gets Hot isn't really a thing anymore, and now I have Torrent Flamers on my Storm Surges. Yeah, it's really, really good.
Stupid
crates.
It's
a great way to hide your drones behind it. Like, they're a big force multiplier for Tau. So I was running those with a Calexis for my list. I ended up dropping Feel No Pain off my Riptides, which I still feel bad about, but it seems to be working.
If only you could fit in an addition to, because Feel No Pain is huge.
If I get rid of the Assassin, I can. But anyway, lists later. So I bought the kit. It's $60 or something after tax here, with a little bit of a discount from the shop.
You just get one or you get two?
You get three.
You get three crates.
You get three crates
and all the other shit.
12 armor, 12 ammo dumps, and 9 barrels.
So that's a good deal just for like battlefield terrain.
Yeah, that was the thing. I figured if I wasn't going to use them, they're at least terrain for table. Yeah, and they're really good value. The kits are pretty good too. They go together pretty well. They did something really weird on the sprue though. You know, normally you just have like the little bit you snip off. For these have like big wide bits that you have to like clip through multiple times to get them off the sprue. It's kind of odd.
That's weird. Never seen that.
Took a lot of filing, but they turned out great. So, 2 thumbs up.
That's awesome. Yeah. Well, if you go back a few shows, I don't even remember the episode number, but we did a whole thing on the crates.
Yep.
And we came to that same conclusion back then, and they're still relevant today. I'm surprised you don't see them more. It could be because of the price point and the fact that they sold out, but...
Yeah, I saw a bat rep on YouTube, some guy with sisters, just flamers stacked up behind the stupid barrels, like, torrenting away. It was pretty funny.
No, they're amazing value for the points.
Yeah. Cool, but anything else?
That's it for me, man. I've just been packing, because I'm moving in 2 weeks, so... And
Darren.
Moving.
I'm moving next week. I'm supposed to be packing right now, but I'm not, clearly. I'm moving next week and basically making plans for my new gaming basement, basically. I'll have space for 4 tables, probably, and with space to move around them. Lots of built-in shelving. I'm going to get some studio lights, and it's going to be pretty sweet.
Nice.
So that's my my hobby, basically. And... watching videos and making list after list of ways to beat the Nyx Chaos Demons, and secretly reading AOS rules.
Nice.
You're struggling with Nyx Demons? That's a dig at them. I'm just kidding.
I beat them the first time by like a point or 2 points. Trying to make a Ravenwing list I can beat them with.
I have a Ravenwing list I've been working on that. I don't know. I think it would do quite well against demons, but it's just spammy garbage, as I usually play. So I guess we can move on to news and new releases. So I'll start, because there hasn't been a lot in AOS news, and that's what I run with usually. Beastclaw Raiders have arrived. It's a $40 hardcover book, but as this is something that I want to bring up right now, because we do have a lot of 40K players that are looking to branch into AOS, you don't need to buy that book. A friend of ours, Jamie, just bought it. He was like, there's no points in here, and there's no this, and I was like, yeah, you actually, the rules are free online. The book is just a fluffy camp kind of supplement that you don't really need. You can buy the few formations that are in there for $2 on the app if you don't want to. And I think that's something that maybe GW falls short in, is that they don't inform.
Yeah.
We talked about this at the general skip. They don't inform the AOS players like what they need to play it. It's not clear. So, you know, because he bought this book, and he's like, you mean I didn't need to buy this? And I was like, well, you play the army. It's a cool book. He's like, yeah, I don't regret it, but I thought that if I bought this book, I could just play with my ogres.
Yeah, and so certainly when I was looking at that stuff recently, it's not clear what exactly you need to buy. Obviously, you need the handbook, but do you need that? Is that just a fluff book, or does it have like stuff in it, or you know, it's unclear. Yeah.
So I'm going to start with just the quick answer, guys, is don't buy anything except the General's Handbook and download the GW app, because that's the best thing to do. And personal opinion, buying the General's Handbook within the app is the best option. So I wouldn't even buy any books. I know this is like GW might get mad and say shit like that, but I would buy, just download the app, buy the General's Handbook in the app, and then if you really love a faction, like you're a Seraphon nutbag, then you could buy that book for your shelf. But you don't need to right away. You're better off buying a model kit to make your army if you're a new player. So that's my rant on that. I'm sorry, you guys have anything to add?
So what's the advantage of buying the General's Handbook in the app versus having it separately?
The advantage to buying the General's Handbook in the app is it's a 2/3 of the price, and it applies point values to all the war scrolls in the app.
Okay, so otherwise you don't get any of the points in the app.
Yes, so by buying it in the app, I can... with my iPhone, because I walk a lot. I don't know, do I look really tanned or at least really red? I literally walk something like 25 kilometers a day because I don't know what it is. I like to walk. And I can access all the stuff on my iPhone, all the point values, and I can make lists and stuff while I walk. And it's really, really handy to have that.
That's fair.
You know, you're waiting in a train station. It's just better to have it available than having a book at home where you can't really do that.
Also worth pointing out, before we move on from AOS, all of the Battlescribe repositories for Age of Sigmar are out. So if you want those rules for free, they're up there on the... just go to the Battlescribe data website. They're
so,
all there.
So is it true with these Beast Claw things, you can literally field a proper army with just six models?
Yes.
That appeals to me.
It's a very small elite army. It's very cool. So, and then also, there's also an Icewind Assault box, which is, I think, is a steal. Because I played 8th edition, so... it's $265. You get several of the large monster kits. You get a bunch of Yetis, and Yetis used to be a very expensive kit to buy in Finecast. It's a wicked box. But in AOS in general, you can do some really small elite armies, but I'm going to save that because we have some questions later for that.
Yep.
So we'll move on. That's it for AOS. I'll hand it off to Logan for 40K rumors.
All right. So
news.
Yeah, mostly news today, actually. Not so much on the rumor side. There's a new Death Watch game, except it's not really a Death Watch game. It's a new 40K starter set. It's $180. It's called Death Mask. Comes with Harlequins and Eldrad.
Oh, it's fluff, so good.
I guess. But it's a new Eldrad, the plastic one. It's just a great looking kit. And it comes with Death Watch, you know, which I think is like a Dreadnought, the Veteran Squad, a Captain, and some other stuff.
It's like a tactical squad equivalent. They're not called that. And then it's the assault squad as well.
I'm sorry, the assault squad, too.
Dreadnought and that Captain Artemis guy.
Yep.
But I think they're full kits. From what I've seen,
yep.
And it's like they come with, like, so you'll buy it, it'll be like Flesh Terror shoulder pads. Like, it'll be like 20 shoulder pads. You can mix and match. It looks fantastic.
It's none of the snap fit stuff like they had for the old ones. These are the full normal kits, which is...
and that's what you expect for a $180 box.
Yeah, it's still killer value at that price, though. I mean, if you sell off half of that, you're still coming out ahead by like $40-$50. So it comes with a 40K rule book with alternate cover art. I think it's like Death Watch cover art.
Oh, it's so good.
And it comes with a mini rule book?
Yeah, mini rule book, right. Paperback. And comes
which is hard to get.
Yep, they're tough to find otherwise.
You can only get them in the Blood Angel box, and a lot of people are pissed off about that, because in previous editions they were so readily available.
I had to get it off eBay.
Yep. Anyway, it comes with all the rules for the minis and the formations. The full rules have already been leaked, of course. I think it's actually out. I guess it comes out this Saturday. The full rules are up on Bowls. You can go check it out there. I'll put a link to it in the show notes. But yeah, they've got some pretty cool stuff. We'll talk about them in a future show, probably, because they're getting like Death Watch has its full codex now. Yeah. It's not just this, so that's pretty good. But yeah, we'll talk about that in another show.
And spoiler: there's a flyer that's crazy good.
Yeah, it looks
is there?
Cool.
Oh, is that the assault one?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's an assault vehicle flyer that can transport bikes. It's pretty awesome.
And jump infantry.
Yeah, but yeah, it's a small capacity though. I think it's like 5 models or something.
I'm okay when they're all Death Watch brothers, ready to die.
Other news, ETC wrapped up last weekend. Team Canada came in 14th place, going 2 wins, 2 losses, 2 ties. So pretty solid middle of the pack.
Good job, well done, boys. We're really proud of you guys. They did quite well, considering that this is their first year going to play 40K. I think that placing the top half was a real significant achievement. And you know what? Like, I just, you know, just they all did really well. So, like, some of the scores, like Dan, I think, was third.
Third out of total everyone went.
Of the whole ETC. And Kieran was right up there as well. And yeah, so like Kieran was on a few shows ago, yeah. And he did extremely well with his battle company, which was normally poo-pooed by the Europeans because of all the kill points. They said it wasn't worth it, but he maybe proved that, you know, when you have that much grab and that much scouting Marines, it doesn't matter if you get lose all the kill points because you win everything else. So
Team Canada is counter meta.
And, counter meta.
And shout outs to all my American buddies. They came in 10th, one single battle point ahead of Team Canada, but they had a win instead of one of our ties. So they went, I guess, 3-2-1. Really good showing from them. Aaron Aylong was also really high up. I think he was like 13th or something overall.
Which is pretty good.
Did really well with his like eight Iron Priest list with his Lib Conclave, the Dark Angels one. So that was pretty cool. But yeah, so ETC's wrapped up. So it's another good season. We'll see everyone. Well, I won't because I won't be there. But you know, whoever's going, we'll see each other next year.
Yeah, and we're already in the works, guys. We want to bring more ETC to Ontario. So if you'd like to help us with that, let us know. But we would like to start running, not all, because ITC is still very important in the comp, but we would like more practice events across the province. So stay tuned for that. If you're interested, send us an email, canhammer.podcast@gmail.com, if you want to play something different, right, and maybe help get the team ready. Any ITC news?
Nada. Nothing really going on there between polls. They seem to be doing Tuesday night fights again over on Frontline Gaming, as time permits, so not super reliable, but they got one on tonight, actually. It's KDK and Renegades versus... Warcon. War Convocation. Yep.
That'd be an awesome game. So I guess we're going to move on. We added a new segment. This may come and go depending on what kind of content we have. It's called Corrections and Emails. And so we answer a lot of your questions in the later part, but we get a lot of emails that don't ask questions. And, you know, we want to give these people a shout out if they're good to us. If they're bad to us, we just ignore them. But so the first thing is correction. On our last show, which is an AOS show, this is a little bit of AOS we're going to talk about. As per the FAQ, I guess we're going to talk about more when we get to our main topic of choosing armies. But anyway, as per the FAQ, you can always select the Grand Alliance Allegiance. So I had mentioned, because I was going raw off the General's Handbook, that you could only select, if you chose to be a sub-faction like Stormcast Eternals Allegiance, then you had to take the Stormcast Eternals if they existed, which they don't, so it's a bad example, but you'd have to take their Allegiance abilities, but you don't. Every faction, even though they could be assigned as a different sub-faction to get the different battle line troops, can always take the Grand Alliance traits, which is really nice for everything right now, basically, because that was a big worry of ours. If you're playing Bretonians, well, that's a bad example as well because they have a lot of battle line. Which one am I thinking of? Oh, it's the what's the faction that you wanted to play, Darren?
Malignants.
Malignants. That's one. Yeah. So if you take a pure malignant army, then you get Spirit Host, I do believe, as battle line. But the way that we were interpreting that is that you could no longer take the Grand Alliance Death strategic traits. You could only take malignant ones, which didn't exist yet, and they corrected that in the FAQ. So I hope that makes sense. Sorry, guys, for that one. And then the second correction we made is we knew this, and we just kind of overlooked it really quickly, is the scenarios say deploy unit by unit, but in the GW FAQ, you can deploy War Scroll Battalions as one unit in the deployment phase. So you can either deploy individual units or a whole War Scroll Battalion. I still kind of don't agree with that. Because that some of the GW FAQs are for open play and not necessarily matched play. But for Capital City, I decided to change the ruling to go as raw as possible. So you can deploy a whole War Scroll Battalion, which of course allowed certain people, won't mention them, John, to have one deployment for his entire army.
Yeah, that'll happen when you've got 16 units, a single battalion.
Yeah. So it is what it is. If it starts getting crazy, then we're going to go back to individual units and say War Scroll Battalions be damned. But as of now, I said, why give Raw a shot first? You should go as raw as possible.
Yep.
Giggity. Awesome. So then I wanted to just give a shout out to a few people that wrote us some really nice emails over the past little while and that maybe I didn't get to answering because we've been fairly busy. Austin from Texas, we're going to give him a shout out. He gave us an awesome email saying some good things about the show. So thanks for the email. We really appreciate it. It's why we do it. Rostin, I think I said that right. Stay tuned. It's your army list that we're we're going to answer your question in the Q&A in the end of the episode, but thanks for the nice kind words. He's also and then John McNeil sent us a couple emails over the last couple shows. He's been a long-time listener, so we just want to give him a shout out. And then I want to talk about his response as we were talking about how we weren't selling War Machine tickets because they were too expensive. And he basically said he went to a War Machine event and found that it was a common practice for some of them to drop out when they lose, because it's win-loss-draw. If you lose like game two, you're basically out of the tournament. Yeah. So it was more common for them to kind of show up at their store, play a few rounds. If they lose, kind of go home or go play something else or play practice games. And he says that might be just the fact that that culturally is different from us, whereas we play total battle points. So you can play six rounds and, you know, you could lose a game and still maybe place high and you're playing for points and placings. Whereas for them, it's all about the win. So they tend to not want to invest into a nicer gaming experience because they don't want to actually play after they've already been eliminated.
So that was a conversation that came up with Yoshi, actually. I was chatting with him earlier today. We were talking about some of the differences between win-loss-draw formats or straight battle points. So to put it in perspective, ITC runs win-loss-draw. So you've got your 11 points you can get in a game, and then a win is 1,000 points on top of that, a draw is 500, and a loss is 0. Basically what that means is if you're an event that's over 255 people, I think is the cutoff, 256, if you lose a single game, it's impossible for you to make top 8. So unless you care about your placement outside of that, you may as well go home. So if you go to LVO expecting to make it through to the finals, or really to get ITC points worth a damn, and you lose game 1, you may as well just go gamble, because you're not going to place. Which is not something I necessarily like, nor do I agree with. That's it. I mean, their tournament, run it however you guys want.
I would argue that for that one, at least, like if I lost game 1, I would still play and try to get max points get like 10th, just so even if I'm like 20th overall, just to get the maximum amount of points possible.
No, I would too. But where I'm going with it is what that boils down to is, let's say you play a super tight game. Like you're up first round against, Frankie or someone, like a really good player, right?
You go in there. I win easily, okay.
Oh, money match. Anyway. Let's say you guys are playing your game, and it's a complete tie. You guys are like neck and neck, and one of you has first blood and the other doesn't. Whoever has first blood just prevented that other guy from making top 8 for 1 point, which is not something I'm a huge fan of. The way we're doing a bloodbath, on the other hand, is straight victory points with that 30-0 differential, kind of like we used to do for fantasy with a 20-0 system. Basically, you could lose a game. You could get 0 points. And you could get, max 30 points every other game, and you still got a really good shot at being in that top 8 or being very, very high up.
Yeah, but that's different too. That the argument of the way that of total battle is, and this, it doesn't grind my gears at all, but I could like win all my games and then lose table 1 in the final to Dan Platt, and then I'm end up being like 8th, 9th, 10th place, and I'm tied with 5 other guys. And the other guys are like, oh, look, I did as good as Chris. But it's like, well, two of you lost your first game, so you didn't do the same, right? It allows for submarining, which I've taken advantage of, and I've got screwed over because of, so.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, there's pros and cons of both systems. I mean, that's purely my opinion on the subject, and that's how we're doing 40K for it, but. Anyway, just building off, the sort of win-loss-draw mentality that can come with that.
So I thought that was cool, that it kind of explained their situation. Yeah. And plus, War Machine events, there's like one every weekend, apparently, and they're not as... So for a Warhammer, it's like a big event, like, oh, we're going to a tournament, we're going to play. But for them, it's like they expect events regularly because of the hyper-competitive nature of the hobby. So we'll move on to, unless you have anything to add, Darren, we're going to move on to Event Spotlight. So what's the, take it away, Logan.
All right. So Capital City Bloodbath. Let's talk about that again. We're less than 2 weeks out. We still have tickets left. If you are interested, please, please, please purchase ahead of time. The further out it is, the easier it is for us to budget, get prizes sorted out, get food sorted out for everyone, and just make sure everyone has as best a time as possible. We've got 38 people signed up for 40K singles, 26 for 40K doubles, 20 for Age of Sigmar. This may or may not be fact, but I think this makes us the biggest ITC event in Canada.
Nope, Edmonton has a bigger one.
Do they? Because I've never seen it on their site.
It's posted on Frontline as a major.
What's the name of the event?
Something Edmonton.
All right.
I'm looking at going to it. I want to go to it, but I don't know if I can.
Anyway, 2 weeks left. Come out, make us the first Canadian major, because we're before Edmonton's event. But also go to Edmonton's event, because they need some love over there.
If we can go, I don't know.
If we can go. Anyway, past that, Nova Open is in 3 weeks. That's in Washington, D.C., September 1st to 4th. I think they've got close to 200 people signed up for that, for the 40K singles. A bunch of CanHammer guys are going, so you can hang out with us there. Hopefully lose to us, but I won't be there. Chris won't be there. But Yoshi and a bunch of those guys will be going, so you can say hi to them. All right.
So that's it. So I guess we're just going to take a really quick break. We'll be right back to talk about how to choose an army. Excuse me. Okay, so we're back, and we're going to talk about how to choose an army, because we thought it would be appropriate, because with this new AOS coming out, we're getting lots of emails on people that want to play certain factions, want to play this and that. We get quite a few questions in 40K, like, what army should I start with? I'm new to the hobby. You know, which faction should I pick? So we thought it'd be a good time. And as well, Darren has basically been going through this a lot. And I've also been going through this a lot recently, too, with a little bit of army jumping, where you can't quite decide what you want to do. So I guess we'll start off with that. So how do you guys choose an army?
That's a great question.
Yeah.
So, you know, it comes out of a lot of different things for different people, right? Is it, do you go by the fluff? Are you a big fluff bunny? You know, like Darren is, obviously. Do you go for how strong the army is, like Chris? Or do you go purely for visual appeal because you like big robots like I do and you end up playing Tau?
That's not really fair, but you have a good point. That's not fair to me. I do actually play armies that I like. People don't realize about me, I'm a fluff reader. I have a shelf. I think I've read something like 300 Black Library books. Like, yeah. I'm actually a fluff bunny, but
I hate everybody. I think the important thing is to realize for most people, myself not included, but you have to spend a lot of time with these things. You got to put them together. You got to paint them. You got to learn how to play them. And if you don't like how they look, I find it hard to believe that you're going to play them for any decent amount of time.
Yeah. I mean, another big thing is playability. And if somebody just brought this up in the chat sort of mockingly, but it's very true, is I hate playing Horde armies. I enjoyed them in fantasy, but not in 40K. So, like, my ideal army is, you know, under 30 models. So that's one of the big things I look for. And it's one of the reasons, I mean, if you listen to the last podcast, I'm kind of disappointed that my flesh eaters for AOS are so many models. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, so let's define, we basically have gone through, and there's basically three, as they both allude to, there's three main ways to do factions. And so let's define them. So what is a fluff army? So if I was to tell somebody, this is my, like I go to an event, I say, oh, this is my fluff army. What would that be to you?
So it'd be something that's based off of the overarching stories of Warhammer or Age of Sigmar. So, you know, you base it around certain characters. Like if you're running a Salamander's army, you know, you've got a lot of Flamers and Melta in there as opposed to, you know, giving them plasma guns or something. You know, you've got Vulcan. Or if you're running White Scars, you've got a bike heavy army. Ultramarines, you've got, your Gladius. All that kind of stuff. Or you're playing Tau, you know, maybe you base your army around Farsight. Maybe you're super fluffy and you play the 8. You know, something like that.
Yeah, like a recent, my recent game against Nick, you know, I was playing Ravenwing and he asked me, why did I bring Samael? And I'm like, because it's Samael. He's the chapter master of the Ravenwing. Yep. I mean, that's, you have to bring him, you know.
Exactly.
That's all there is to it. You have to at least own him. Yeah.
So I guess fluffy can mean that you take something that is actually present and could be hypothetically read about in a Black Library book and is totally legit within the lore of the 40K universe. Yeah. Now, this is something that I wanted to get into. But the second you wrote fluffy in this thing, I was like, ooh, I want to talk about, does a fluffy army have to be suboptimal?
Nope. I think Ravenwing's a good example of a decent army that's pure, you know, if you stick all Ravenwing, that's pretty fluffy, looks great, and you know, could be pretty effective.
Because I noticed this a lot, that it's not perceived that way. So if I show up with 15 units of Eldar jet bikes, three with scatter lasers, and they're painted red, and they have the Sanheim Craft World, which is, for those of you that aren't really into, Sanheim is a bike-based, fast, lots of Vipers, lots of bikes, Craft World that's back in 3rd edition, they had a Craft World Codex, and that was one of the advantages, is that you could take bikes as troops. And if I was to go to an event, I feel, with a Sanheim army and go, this is my list, it's fluffy, I think a lot of people on DACA or in person would be like, that is not fluffy, that's horrendous.
Yeah, that's and what's your take on that? I think that sort of builds into a different problem that 40K has. There's definitely nothing about that isn't fluffy. Right, it works out great. It's like playing an Ultramarines Gladius. It's you know, over the top powerful, but it fits the lore perfectly. Right, it's a great thing to do. Or you know, Libby Conclave with Tigerius. You know, it all makes sense in the fluff. It's when those start sort of bleeding into the what's perceived as the more powerful list that you start to get the hate about it. But yeah, especially with the changes in, you know, the newer 7th edition codexes, there's a lot more carryover between both being fluffy and being powerful. And you know, Eldar and Space Marines are fantastic examples of those right now.
Yeah.
Okay. And so I guess the one last point is the reason a Gladius is fluffy is that why, Darren? Why would somebody say a battle company is fluffy? Do you know?
Well, or do you have an answer to that? I would consider battle companies fluffy. First of all, you're playing all the same chapter.
Yep.
You're using tactical marines. I think that's probably fluffy just in and of itself. And rhinos. and you know, it just has this cohesive look, like all these dudes could be on the battlefield together. You know, there's not random, you know, Iron Priest stuck in there or you know, a Storm Surge in the back or something like that. So, you know, yes, and I agree. I think fluffy armies can be strong, and that's the way that the game is at the moment, that there are some fluffy armies that are strong, and, you know, that's fine. Doesn't mean they're not fluffy, though.
Yeah. And to clarify for the chat, Barkstar is not fluffy. It's furry.
That's a whole different hobby, Yoshi. But, have you ever picked... start with you, Darren. Have you ever picked an army based on fluff? And if so, which ones and why?
Yeah, so the first bunch of miniatures I bought was Grey Knights and Inquisition, basically, because Inquisition is kind of cool. Like, just reading the books and reading about them in Heresy and stuff, and the way the Grey Knights are like the ultra elite sort of hunters and stuff. And so that's cool, and the models look cool. I personally like the baby carriage Dread Knight, but
yeah,
and so I picked, that was my first bunch of models I picked up, and that was purely based on fluff. Cool. And to some extent, so is Ravenwing. I love the Ravenwing fluff. Read all the novels and stuff, and both 30K and 40K, and also all the sort of Fenrisian type lore, and I like the Vikings and stuff from school, and so to some extent, all the armies I play, I picked mostly based on fluff and look of the models.
Cool. So yeah, because it's kind of funny that that Space Wolf trilogy is probably one of the best. Is it the trilogy or it's? But there's a Space Wolf series from Black Library that's one of the best books I think I've ever read. Was that Ragnar Blackmane? Was that the one? I think.
Okay.
But anyway. So, Logan, you ever pick an army based on fluff?
You know, you'd think I'd be the last person to do it, but... So, the first army I ever played was Tyranids, and the first army I collected in any sort of organized fashion was actually Gene Stealer Cult. And this is back when they were only available in the Citadel Journal, so I had to go to a games day to actually find this issue of Citadel Journal
to
buy.
With the limos?
Yeah, exactly, with the limos, I had a Patriarch. All this is long gone, unfortunately. But yeah, I was big into the Tyranid fluff. I thought it was the coolest thing ever. And then, out of all strange things, I started playing Necrons in 3rd edition. Because I thought they'd be really cool. And I didn't like them because I didn't like the fluff enough. I didn't feel like the army had enough personality. And then when I came back, started playing again in 6th edition, I picked up Chaos Space Marines. Because I loved Chaos, and I played in 3rd edition as well. They were really cool. I used to run, Karn with a whole bunch of Berserkers. I was really into the Chaos fluff, especially for Khorne. A little more on the Nurgle side these days, but yeah, definitely. I mean, it's really cool to have fluffy elements in a competitive list. It lets you do a lot of stuff on the hobby side to tie things together too, which I think makes it a lot more fun from an overall hobby perspective as well as gameplay. Because you can forge.
I suspect a lot of people will be buying the new Deathwatch stuff is just because Deathwatch is so cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know how good the rules are. I've not read it yet, but they're pretty cool.
Yeah,
it's a cool concept when they mix the books are written that way that they're. I think I've read
Space Marines.
Yeah,
a few short stories of them. They're kind of like, you know, Band of Brothers style, just kind of. So I've actually I have a few fluffy armies that I like. The first one is it's my second army ever, which was Astra Militarum, which at the time was Imperial Guard. I love them fluff wise. One of my favorite series is Caiaphas Kane, or Caiaphas. How do you... I say it Caiaphas. You guys don't know? Somebody's going to make fun of me. I always get made fun of. It's fine. Caiaphas Kane, Commissar, kind of funny, the whole, like, for the Imperium. Like, I love Saving Private Ryan. I love Starship Troopers. And then I found the Guardsmen just really were what I thought sci-fi would be like. The Space Marines I thought were a bit too over the top at the time. So I love them. I remember reading stories about Nork the Dog, and I own two of those models just because he's so cool that he which, you know, protect his you know, lieutenant or captain that he's assigned to with his life. And so they're really cool. And then the second fluffy army, and people that knew me back in 5th and 4th edition would know that I played this army to death, even though it was suboptimal, and that was my Deathwing.
Yep.
And I only ever played pure Deathwing, which was Dreadnoughts and Terminators and nothing else. And I lost a lot of games because I stuck to that just fluffy. And that was all I played for the longest time. So I definitely get it. Picking an army on fluff is probably the most rewarding, because even if you lose the games, you still have models that you love and you still have background that you love, and you can identify, I think, with your army a little bit more than somebody that's just playing to win the game.
Yeah, I basically got completely wiped by Nick. I scored like 1 point the whole game, but it was cool just seeing all the bikes on there, and yeah, it was pretty, even when they're off on the graveyard area, that was even cooler because they were all close together. It was pretty cool.
Cool. So then, I guess this is a little segue, because this one is basically fluff as well. We kind of combined them. So be quick, is visual appeal. So visual appeal from my perspective is when you pick an army just based on how cool the models are, which is what Darren said about Deathwatch and things like that. But that could also be fluff, kind of, if you like it, but... Have you guys ever bought an army that's just because you like the models? I guess we've already kind of talked about that. But yeah.
I've got like 4,000 points of Tau.
Yeah, and you know, if I'm getting into AOS, I think that's what I'm basing it on, is because some of those models are just pretty sweet.
Yeah.
And that one's all, it's personal preference. We can't really, you know, if you love an army because it looks good and you don't care about anything else and that's what you want, that's another way to select an army. And then the third way, which is the one that might, you know, we might get into a little bit more, is power level. So when you select an army on power level, what are you doing, Logan?
All right. So this sort of ties into the whole meta game of Warhammer or any game, right? Like if I was going to go into War Machine, at the time I was looking at Signar because it was good and it was War Machine. But for Warhammer stuff, yeah, the power stuff shifts around a fair bit. But really, this may fall under more of the like flavor of the month kind of stuff. So, you know, if you're starting now and you want to play a super strong army, you know, maybe you're going to pick up Eldar. Maybe you also think Eldar are cool and look cool. If so, more power to you. But it'd be that kind of thing. You know, instead of getting, you know, some swooping hawks, some striking scorpions, all these different aspect warriors, maybe you just go out and you buy 40 bikes and a Wraith Knight. Maybe you're that guy. It's just a different approach to actually building that list and choosing that army. You know, it's the mindset of, okay, I want to play this game, I like these models, but above everything else, I want to take these and I want to win games, or I want to have, you know, really highly competitive games, which in your meta maybe means Deathwing, but, you know, in the bigger scheme of things, it's not Deathwing.
Not even in your meta.
Yeah. You should sell me your Deathwing, Chris.
Yeah. I mean, maybe you're going out and you're buying, you know, a bunch of Wraiths to play Necrons, or you're buying, you know, a ton of Rhinos and Tactical Marines to play Gwadius, or as I said, like a bunch of Bikes or Storm Surges or, you know, 8 Riptides or something. You're picking the power units for your army build.
So the thing that I want to get more into this, now that we've defined it, a lot of people email me about this. How do you find power builds? How do you know what's good? Like, I'm coming into this and I go, hey, Logan, I want to win. I want to go to a tournament. I just want to win. What do I do? Like a new guy right off the street, he has, I don't know. Well, we'll say money's not a huge option. Super competitive dude. But like within moderation, of course. Right. But we'll take that aspect out of it.
So one of the things we did actually a couple weeks ago after a show, and I think I tossed this up on YouTube somewhere, was one of our buddies, Jamie, was actually looking to do exactly this. He has a huge collection of Space Marines, a whole bunch of Knights, a bunch of other stuff, Tyranids, you know, huge collector, big hobbyist. And he said, you know, hey, I want to go to Capital City Bloodbath, whatever tournament, and I want to do well, right? Like, I want to get top 10. These are the models I have. This is what I'm, you know, what I'm willing to buy, if anything. How can we, you know, pimp my list? And in that case, you know, really, I think this is a great approach, is just to brainstorm with a bunch of people who play, especially people who, you know, have some more experience, or, you know, a bit more seasoned when it comes to building lists and playing in events, and, you know, just the more competitive mindset for it. When I started out, for example, I thought, hey, I'm going to run 9 Obliterators and Plague Marines. Those things are awesome.
They're not. Yeah.
So, not anymore. You know, you learn that the hard way. So what you think is good, you know, may not actually be all that great, as we found out. And as I found out when I played against 3 Wraith Knights and a bunch of Wave Serpents. This is back in 6th, of course. But, yeah, I think it's the biggest and best way to do that is just to sit down with a bunch of other players, figure out, you know, what their opinion is on different things, figure out how you can build that into your list. And then over time, as you do that more and more, you play more and more games, you're going to start to see the crazy stuff that comes out of that. So, you know, maybe I take this unit because it'll debuff something if it charges in, or it'll, you know, eat Overwatch super effectively and set me up for other charges. Or like in Fantasy, for the longest time, I had no idea why anyone ever used like Dire Wolves or Marauder Cav or any of this stuff. And then I played against Fast Cav and I was like, oh, yeah, that's like the greatest thing in this game. I've been doing it wrong all these years. So it's sometimes you gotta like play against it to figure out why something is so good. Because on paper, Fast Cav don't sound that amazing. And then you abuse them like there's no tomorrow. Or like double fleeing Skinks and Pterodons back in Lizardmen days. It's the kind of stuff you don't necessarily think of until you actually see somebody use it. So
yeah,
a lot of it comes to that experience.
So what I like to do when I... So, you know, no lie, if you listen to this, you know that I'm competitive and I go to win. And what I like to do is when I want a competitive army, you know, I generally look at the books that are doing well at the current time. Like, I'll never... Like, I have a Sisters of Battle army, but I don't even think of them. Like, that's like for little store tournaments, 8 to 10 men, just for fun. But I look at, like, okay, which armies win tournaments? Now, they don't have to always win, but, like, right now in 40K, I looked at that and I go, okay, Demons, Eldar, Ravenwing of Space Wolves, and a whole bunch of other things. You're like, these are the top 5 to 6 books that I know it's possible to win with. And then you have to kind of take a grain of salt and take out some of the anomalies. And this is done by doing a little bit of research. So if you would have looked at LVO last year, or year before last, when Tyranids won, that's an anomaly. That's the exception to the rule. And I know a lot of people now, and you'll say, Nids suck. Well, they won LVO. Yeah, that is a very rare case.
Yeah.
You know, I like to look at odds on a whole. Like, not, you know, like, you can look at a tournament and go, well, look, that Astra Militarum player, he wins all our local tournaments. Yeah, but there's 5 other Astra Militarum players that are in the bottom 25%. So
how
maybe
about the Dark Angels Lion's Blade that just won BAO? I think that's an anomaly or real?
I actually think that that's real because the Dark Angels book is good. He had the Lion's Blade Gladius, which is the same as the White Scars one. It doesn't scout, okay, but it's still pretty good. And then he had a support formation of Ravenwing Bikes.
Yeah.
Specifically Black Knights, and Black Knights are one of the best units in the game.
Yeah.
So
the Lion's Blade is really, really strong. You know, it's right up there with Gladius. If you optimize the auxiliary choices, right? Yeah. So you only need the one demi company, and then you can take an auxiliary. So if you build it out the way it was done there, it's very, very strong.
Yeah.
Where a lot of people sort of get thrown off on it, I think, is if you try to build a Lion's Blade like a Gladius and you run 2 demi companies, you run out of points way too fast because you don't get those free transports.
That's exactly what I... And the other issue with it is that the White Scars 1 is a slight bit better.
Yeah.
And its organization and structure is so similar, and most people do their own DIY chapters, that it's almost like, why would you run it? You know, it's like one of it's just a little bit worse, but because he took the Black Knights, it made it a bit better. And then of course matches do tend into that. But I believe that Dark Angels are in the top echelon of the game right now. So, but that's what I generally have to do is you look at that and then you pick the army, and you got to go online and read about it. You get a lot of army lists. I like to look at ETC army lists because they're usually a little bit different than what people perceive as good. I like to look at guys like, if you want to play Demons, you'd look at guys like, what's Nick Nottavati running? What's that other guy?
Justin
tall,
Curtis. Is
Justin Curtis. What's
one,
he running?
Who else? Their pajama
Dan
pants.
Platt.
Yeah, Dan.
You know, you look
like,
at that.
There's tons of great Demon players.
Because you're going to ask somebody off the street. You, like, if I go up to you, Darren, and you played a game, and you're playing Sisters of Battle, and I go, oh, how'd your game go? You go, oh, man, those, I don't even know what to what the hell they're called. Not Retributors, that's Age of Sigmar. What are the Ignore Cover Melted girls called?
Oh, Dominions?
Dominions, that's it. And you're like, oh, the Dominions are awesome. They're the star of the show. But then it's like you lost most of your game. So, yes, they might have been the star of the show and carried it, but they still didn't perform.
Your show sucked.
So, yeah, you know what I mean? So like, you have to be careful of that. And then you also have to be careful of things like DACA. Like, if you post your list on DACA, you are more likely to get trolled or get an idiot to comment on your list than that. And that's why when people get us to pimp their list, we try not to just destroy them and rewrite them. We try to embrace them. We always give the caveat, like, it's still like how you play matters.
Yeah.
So it doesn't necessarily always make a difference. So that's kind of the things that I do.
One important note as well. I mean, Chris mentioned, looking online for lists, or getting feedback on lists online. And, DACA is like a poster child of where not to get advice, but you need to, balance out your information sources. Like, just with any kind of research you ever do, you don't want to take everything from one person, just like you shouldn't take advice purely from us. You should take it from Chris and never me. But
if you want to play Tau, I don't know anything.
Yeah.
You could send me 300 Tau lists, I could never help you.
There you go.
I don't get some credit.
But
yeah, I don't get them.
A good example of this is if you go online, you go on Warseer or DACA or Bolter and Chainsword, you're going to find a lot of people who think that Tzeentch demons are just awful. They're terrible. Their demon power is half useless. They're just crap. Why would you ever play them? And then you have literally everyone who knows what they're talking about saying the exact opposite, right? So you gotta filter your information, put it through the lens of where it's coming from. To figure out what's going on.
Look at date stamps. Like, we could do a podcast right now about the Lord of Change being awesome, and then this Death Watch book could come out, and there could be an item in it where on a 2+, a Lord of Change explodes out of the sky, and it's no longer relevant. So you have to kind of keep that up. And so one thing that I want to point out is we're not talking about how to win events. We're just talking about how to pick an army. Because, yes, I understand, like, the best way to design a list is to play a game 200 times, with the demon army, just play it and modify it. But we're just kind of going, like, from a newbie perspective, to set yourself up to succeed, what's the best bet? And so I would do something like that, run a few test games and proxy some models, but mainly just really go to a diverse crowd. If you're listening to a fluff-based podcast, their list advice will not be the same as, like, the guys in England that are doing the ETC ones. But then again, ETC lists are still not relevant in ITC tournaments. Some are, some transfer, some don't. And so you really have to know the environment in which you're getting advice from.
Yeah.
But
and this is another good point, actually, somebody just brought up in the chat, is sort of the general trolling about mutilators, is even in books that are perceived as being the top books, there is a lot of crap sometimes. There are a lot of units that you don't see on the table for a reason in these lists. So it's good to look around, see what people are running. ETC, I think, is fantastic. It's 200 lists from literally some of the best players in the world. They're ETC lists, but it's a great source for inspiration. So you can say, hey, this combo is really cool, but I can't use it in this way. Maybe I'll change the other part of this way so it fits in this comp and see how it works in the missions.
Because it's the only time you'll see a Dark Angels Librarius Conclave.
Is that ETC?
Because the Space Marine one's better, but you don't want to waste the Space Marine book on just a Conclave.
Exactly. And then there's other great resources. There's Tits for Tournaments over on... Blood of Kittens. They usually have like the top 8 or top 16 lists from every major event in North America. There's lots of good stuff. You can see a great example, actually, and I don't want to keep bringing up the name, but it's a great example, is if you're interested in, let's say, like running a Death Star list like Dark Angels and Space Wolves, you think, hey, I want lots of Iron Priests and I want a Ravenwing Command Squad and a Lib Conclave. Great, done. Run with it. The thing is, that works great for the most part, but if you actually want to do really well with these things, you need to figure out how to tailor those to specific events, specific missions. So if you look at a player who consistently runs the same army, and the person in this example is Aaron Alon, is you go through there and you're going to see the same base list for every event he plays in, but there's going to be tweaks for it, you know.
He always tweaks. Exactly. He went to his conference and he said that, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe instead of, like, Wolfgar Battle Leader, he can run a Tech Marine because, you know, in this meta, it's, you know, more about, you know, stuff that's AP3, AP4, or maybe he just has to be a little bit more mobile, so he's going to take a few more troops choices. He needs that OBSEC scoring, stuff like that, just to free up points.
Yeah, and so an example of this is buying a list to win. Is when I was playing 8th edition fantasy at its height, and then I was going to a 40K tournament, and I wanted to win. What I did is I basically went in and I said, okay, these Eldar guys look pretty good. I bought 3 Wave Serpents, 2 units of Dire Avengers, 1 unit of Fire Dragons, bought a Wraith Knight, bang, made an army. And it went quite well there.
I gotta say, when I was, before I actually even bought anything, I spent about 4 or 5 months just surfing YouTube channels, forums, blogs, and just seeing what people are playing, how they're playing it, you know, who seems like they know what they're doing, who doesn't, and then that kind of plays, you know, along with the fluff aspect of it. You know, I didn't want to just buy a duff army, right? But, you know, it plays into it, and you can see what people are doing with their armies and stuff, so, yeah.
So we can move on just to the next point, is how do you guys balance this? How do you balance the, we kind of alluded to that, but we'll make it as a solid point. How do you balance between winning, fluff, and aesthetic? Do you guys have any tricks for that, or?
For me, you know, I mentioned earlier I really like low model count, so I try to base my list around that. And that, fortunately for the armies I play, is sort of the in thing right now. But, you know, maybe I'd jump armies if it wasn't. Really, you have to optimize your choices. So, if you want to play an army. And I'm just going to speak from my experience on this. If you want to play an army that's low model count and you want to, you know, be a top end, you know, competitor in terms of list at least, you know, maybe you're going to play Tau or Space Wolves over Eldar because you don't want to run, you know, 45 Warp Spiders or 30 Bikes or whatever you have. So the way I balance it is basically pick the power units I really like and build a list around those. So for me, it's Riptides. I really, really like Riptides. I think they're an awesome model. They also happen to be amazingly good in the game. So, you know, I've got a list that's 3 Riptides. I've got another list that's like 7 Riptides plus an optimized stealth cadre. But they all fit the theme of low model count plus, you know, giant robots, which I think is really cool. So it doesn't fit the fluff, as far as I know, at all. But, you know, it fits the sort of power curve for it. And I think it looks really, really cool. And I have fun with it because of that.
I think it's helpful if you have resources. So if I've got a whole bunch of Space Wolves, I've got a whole bunch of Dark Angels. If I'm playing a non-competitive game, I can play Space Wolves, I can play Raven Wing, whatever. And then if I decide I want to go to this tournament and win it, well, I've just put those key units together, and now I've got the crazy Death Star. So
yep.
It does help if you have a resources or if you have a larger collection, and then you can just decide what kind of game do I want to play, what kind of game does my opponent want to play. What's the situation I'm playing in, and then just sort of, you know, it's nice if you have flexibility. You know?
Yeah. So no, one thing that, you know, collections matter. You also have to be honest with yourself and what your goals are. So I've tried on many occasions to, oh, hey, I won this box set, or I have this used army I bought, and try to build a list around it just of what I had. And I find it doesn't satisfy me, and it makes me, it's actually funny because when I got back into 7th Ed, I had 3 Wave Serpents, as I just said, and I went, oh, cool, I want to make a competitive Eldar army, and I'll try to build it around these things because I have this Eldar army I do well with, and I ended up just buying a whole new Eldar army, and I don't even use the initial parts that I had because it was all Bikes and Warp Spiders. I didn't have any of those before. So I think that it does help that if you have maybe a fluffy army and a competitive army, or you just have a mix. And if you can only do with one, you just got to be truly honest with yourself. If you're going to be unhappy losing 5 games, then you better just go and say screw fluff, screw aesthetic, and just go full tilt to win. But if you're the kind of guy that just wants to drink and have fun, you can kind of do that. Personally, I have enough fluffy armies for myself that I don't need to. So if I was to go do a new army tomorrow, I wouldn't need to go fluffy. I'd only go competitive because I already have my sisters. I already have my Astra Militarum. Yeah. And that's just because I've been playing. I've been playing competitive Warhammer almost like, I want to say 20 years or 18 years. So
and that's a really good point too, just on the collection side. I mean, even outside of the competitive thing, which I know we talk about a lot, is if you're getting into this game to play with your buddies, or you know, you're not that guy that cares about winning tournaments, you just want to go, you know, have some beers, roll some dice, you know, forge a good hard narrative. It's important to, you know, be able to field a list that you're happy with, because if you want to show up to your local game store and you want to have fun, you want to roll dice with your buddies and have a few laughs, and most importantly have people who will continue to play with you, don't show up with a big dick stomping list. You don't make friends that way. It's like, I run some nasty lists and they will never see play at the local stores unless I arrange ahead of time and they know what's coming. I mean, if you guys follow the channel on YouTube, there's a battle report I did with a buddy of mine, and I thought he was going to bring a nasty list, and he brought Assault Terminators and 2 Land Raiders, and neither of us had fun. So it's the kind of thing you want to avoid. So, you know, I've got...
That's why I only play in tournaments, man, because I can take whatever I want and I don't feel bad.
There you go. So, I mean, I've got my Chaos Space Marines and my my Demonkin for the fluffy, more fun, like laid-back, roll dice, have fun games, where I've got my Brass Scorpion. Or I've got my Tau or my Space Wolves and Dark Angels for the more competitive stuff. So it's good to cater to the audience you're going to be gaming with.
Yeah, cool. So that's I think that's it for choosing an army. I hope we kind of, because just as we said, we get tons of AOS. It's all the same applicable. You know, that you can go find the best build. You can look at the cool models and figure it out. But I always recommend a lot of people. Just before we move on, is they'll go like, it's better to go like, these are the three armies that I like. Which one is the most competitive?
Yeah.
As opposed to going, this is what I want to do, or this is the, just if you're going to ask somebody for advice, it's good to give them options. Like if you email me and go, hey, Chris, I want to play Sisters of Battle. How do I make, like, I want to win. You know, I don't really have an answer for you. But if your question is like, hey, I like Sisters of Battle, I like Ravenwing, and I like something else, I like Imperial Knights,
we can work with it.
Which one is more competitive?
Yeah.
Or, you know, what do I need to buy to make them competitive? It's a little bit more to work with.
And Omega in the chat here actually just brought up a really good point. And this is something the GW used to encourage. This was a long, long time ago, like late 90s kind of thing. They were really encouraging you to do stuff like make your own chapters, right? And it's still covered in the Space Marine Codex. The base rule book still talks about this. And a great example of this is a lot of people I've met who have big Chaos Space Marine collections. You know, maybe they played back in third when they were the hot thing, or maybe they just really like Chaos like I do, and they have this huge amount of stuff. Forge your narrative, right? Maybe you're using Chaos models, but they're WYSIWYG and you're running them as Marines, right? Maybe they're a lost successor chapter that's slowly being converted to Chaos, but are still, you know, still have all the technology. There's nothing in the rules that says you can't do it. I've seen some really cool conversions that people have done for it. Really, nobody's going to knock you on it. As long as you can back it up with something, it's a good option as well.
Yeah, it's a good point and a bad one. I don't know, Chaos Space Marines are Chaos Space Marines to me. But as I said, if you're going to play Space Marines, I personally believe you're better off doing a custom chapter, because then you're not hindered by fluff, as we said. Like, when a guy has an Ultramarines army and it's scouting at you, a lot of people go, I get it, but whereas if it's painted like pink and purple and they're the Joe Blow Marines, they're fine, right?
Yeah, exactly. Successor chapter is also the answer to every question of why is your army not painted for your chapter tactics.
Yeah. But it's irrelevant, it doesn't matter. But then again, that's just kind of your... So we're going to move on, we kind of dragged that out a bit, to Pimp My List, Blood Angels Edition. So Jeff sent us an email, that wasn't that long ago. If you've sent us a list, we get quite a few of them. We try to get an expert on for if we can. Like, we have a Necron list that I'm waiting on, but I want Josh to help me pimp it because he's a Necron player, which makes sense. So we'll try to get to you eventually. But anyway, so Jeff, he basically, you know, says he's a big fan. He really liked Kieran. I just wanted to say that. So, and he said that he wants Kieran to be on a couple more shows in the future, and that can definitely be arranged. He liked being on here, and we like him, so Kieran dropped me $20, I'll let you back on. But he sent us in a 1850 Blood Angels list. It's for Warzone Atlanta. It is a combination from, to go back to our last topic, I would say it's a combination of, he wants to do well, but he also wants it to fit his theme and conversions and modeling potentials. Yep. So he's modeled and converted several dreadnoughts for this list, and he would like us to maybe try and help him make it work. And we'll do the best that we can, as usual, in those things. So we'll start off with it. HQ is a Librarius dreadnought level 2. Melt a gun in a Lucius pattern dreadnought. Drop pod. He has 3 Furiosos, various equipment, frag cannons to melt a guns, in Lucius pattern drop pods. 3 units of 5 scouts, and he put an extra exclamation mark, now ballistic skill 4, and I agree, about time. 3 units of 5 assault marines, 2 with meltaguns, 1 with 2 flamers. 3, and I'm assuming, since he didn't put point values, that it's 3 individual quad mortars.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah. And then an Oathsworn knight detachment with a knight Atropos. So his theory is basically that... armor value 13 dreadnoughts drop in along the enemy battle line. The Lucius drop pod, which we'll talk about in a second, will help them out. The knight, Atropos?
It's Atropos, I'm pretty sure.
Atropos?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm just so bad at this.
Atropos sounds pretty good.
Atropos. It is now the Atropos.
Can run up the table and get within range of his 2D weapons and make a heavy artillery provide some versatile fire support. So he's basically a 3-stage army. The knight moves 12, on the line, up, drop pods come in, so turn 1 you essentially have a wall of armor 13, and then you have some artillery kind of holding the backfield objectives, and the scouts can stop enemy units from scouting on you if you need them to, and they can also go on to objectives. The other option is, he says he wanted to replace, replace 2 of the few, well,
yeah, replace 2 of the Furiosos with the Stormwalkers priority detachment.
Yeah. So, what's that one?
That's cool.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. Is
there a list at ATC with 6 or 7 dreadnoughts in Lucius patterns?
Yep.
I thought I remember somebody saying that, and they wrecked a lot of people because they just weren't expecting it.
Oh yeah, nobody expects it.
So what is a Lucius pattern drop pod for those that are listening? And
so Lucius pattern drop pod, I'm going a little bit from memory here, is basically a drop pod upgrade that only dreadnoughts can take. It's an Imperial Armor 2. It's an assault vehicle, which is the coolest part of it. It's still, you know, you can't charge turn, you come in from reserves, but it allows the dreadnought to come in, chill in the pod, so you can't actually shoot at him. You just keep the doors closed. So you got to get through these, you know, 3 hull points of armor 12. With shrouding for the turn it comes in as well, which is awesome. Plus, because it's shrouding, right, you're getting really good cover saves behind it. And then the subsequent turn, the dreadnought can just charge straight out of it at something. So if this drops in next to your back lines, you either have to kill it and then kill the dreadnought inside it, or you're going to eat, you know, 8 attacks of Furioso Fury the next turn. Which is not fun.
So this is the funny part. When I looked at this list, is I'm just gonna go with the initial list. I don't think flyers have a really high place in competitive game. I know that at the ATC recently, using the Death from the Sky supplement, they were able to abuse the game. I'm assuming that'll be fixed come Warzone time.
So the big thing with just to hop in on that super quickly, the big thing with ATC was that you had the Death from the Skies rules, but there was no mysterious objective, so there was no way for most armies to get Skyfire.
Was that 9 Vendettas or something like that?
Yeah, so there was a guy who was running a whole bunch of Vendettas and Vultures.
And playing like a Wolfstar basically. Yeah. You couldn't do anything.
Yeah.
Which aren't really even in Death from the Skies, but we won't talk about that. Okay, so I looked at this list, like, okay, so when I'm pipping a Space Marine list that's a drop pod heavy one, the first thing I do is I confirmed, and I don't have the book, so I had to confirm that Lucius pattern drop pods do get drop pod assault, so I'm assuming that they do.
Yep.
As far as I've looked, everything I've looked says they do, but they're not. I didn't actually look in a Forge World book. So the first thing I do is I count the amount of drop pods to see what's coming in turn one, and then I try to play in my head what would happen turn one. And so he has the Librarian and the 3 Furiosos, and then he has the 3 Assault Marines. So that's 7 drop pods, which means all 4 Dreadnoughts come in turn one, which is crutch. If he would have had one less drop pod, I would not necessarily, I'd say, try to fit in more. So that's pretty good. That means that you're getting maximum bang for buck, you're hitting them all, and then the assault squads come in later and kind of take objectives. The only critique that I have is that part of me would like you to change the assault marines to tactical marines.
Yes, agreed.
so that you get the OBSEC pods and the OBSEC tactical marines. Then you don't need the scouts, which frees up 150 points, which is more quad mortars or a big unit of quad mortars or a librarian on foot to go in the quad mortars, give them make presence. Them one unit, and give them pre-science is how we say it on this show.
Okay, sorry. Pre-science.
I'm waiting for my opportunity to say it like that.
Yeah.
Okay, so do you guys have anything else to add? Or
yeah, I'm right along the same lines. The two things I do, as Chris said, is swap out the assault marines for tactical squads. You'll basically...
Because they only have one melta... If he had, like, two melta guns in those units, I'd be like, okay, you're going for the special weapons.
Yeah.
But he only has one melta gun anyway, so they're essentially
tactical. Exactly. Guns. You might as well take tactical marines. You're getting fewer attacks, but this stuff isn't charging a lot, right? It's assault marines. Swap them over to tactical marines. You're going to get six OPSEC units instead of three that you have now. If you want to keep the scouts, more power to you. Now you got nine OPSEC units. Or, you know, as Chris said, you take your Libby, get pre-science. And actually, depending on how the points work out, you may be able to get a Libby and the Tech Marine, because the Blood Angels Tech Marine is dirt cheap. So you can have the Tech Marine, you can put all the Rapier quad mortars in a single unit, pre-science them, and put them in some 3-plus ruins, and they're just going to be a force to be reckoned with.
The other wicked thing, sorry, is if you take the librarian on foot, you can take an item. Yes. I knew the name of it.
Yeah,
that gets you two warlord traits on strategic, which increases your chance of getting stealth ruins, plus one reserves, which will be handy with these OBSEC drop pods. You can get plus one to seize, which might be handy in a list like this to seize because of the fact that you're dropping in four dreadnoughts in their grill, armor 13, and then rushing them. Sometimes it's very important to get first turn just to make sure that your Night Titan is off the line and your pods are down, so before the enemy has time to maybe put all of his firepower into your Night Titan, spread out, and then stop your pods a little bit, right?
Yeah, so yeah, swap out.
I'm not saying you always want to go first. I'm just saying
not always, but sometimes.
Helps to get plus one Cs.
Yeah, swap out the assault marines for tactical squads. Toss all the quad mortars in one unit with the librarian for pre-science. Maybe with the tech marine in there as well, and the other thing I do is for the for your third dreadnought there, I just go consistently melta across them. If melta is the thing you want to do, and it looks like it's pretty heavy in the list, I suspect that might be for points. But you know, usually if you want to purpose build this stuff, you're better off having everything with the same loadout for more redundancy for it. Because these guys are going to come in, you're going to pop, you know, the void shield or the bunker or, you know, whatever vehicle you want to get through really quickly. And then you've got, you know, the quad mortars are going to clean up infantry like crazy.
Yeah, I think the quad mortars presence on their own don't do as much as together. I think they're way less effective.
Yeah.
Now the other comment that I had,
multiple barrage, if you can get them all in one unit, you're erasing a unit. It basically, unless it has a 2+ armor save, with three of those in a single unit, Twin Lake Barrage, you're killing whatever you shoot at.
Yeah,
and that's huge. Also, I don't think Warzone Atlanta is using it, but if you're playing with the ITC version of Invis, Twin Lake Barrage is like the best thing imaginable because you can pick off those characters and those invisible Death Stars.
Yeah. The other thing is on his HQ, Librarian Dreadnought, which I wanted to comment, I love Librarian Dreadnoughts. And he wrote in here, too, that he understands that his list is going to be a bit suboptimal, but he would like to make it better. But I love that guy. But the Massacre Legacy of Glory, which is no scatter on him, you don't need it with a drop pod.
No.
I don't know what the other legacies are or the other abilities you can give it, but it might be worth, I don't know how many points it is either, as his list doesn't have points, and I don't have I'm going off like Battlescribe rules. I would say you could probably find something better or use those points elsewhere.
For those points, I think that's high enough. If not, you can shave off 5 points somewhere else. Take an Inquisitor with skulls instead.
Yeah, because he has to drop the two Flamers on the one Assault Marine unit if he makes them tactical squads, which is 5 points. And is that Legacy 40 points? 30 points?
I think it's 30 points. I'm not sure off the top of my head, but most of them are like 25, 30 points. So you should be able to pretty easily, and you've got room for the third detachment if you're playing with three detachment limits. Take an Inquisitor, three Servo Skulls. You're helping out with your drop pods. It's going to help you null deploy as well, right? If you get put in a position where you can't put anything on the table, and you've got that thing that's scattering D6 less, you can toss that pod anywhere you want on the table. Just put your skull somewhere effectively, and you're dramatically reducing the chance that you're going to
screw yourself.
You can
make them a psyker and stick them with the quad.
That's true. Actually, that's a great point. Is you can make your...
level on him and...
exactly.
You
take prescience.
Maybe you don't even need a librarian. Then,
exactly. You take prescience, then you get your tech marine up front to tank for him.
Could you fit?
Super cheap.
Yep.
Well, if you... Yeah, you might be able to fit... No, you don't want to put another... That's too many drop pods. Let's say maybe you want to put another dreadnought in, but you can't do that. But that's a really good point. And then all your drop pods scatter D6 inches. So what if the one doesn't scatter? They all don't scatter hardly at all.
Yeah, exactly.
And it keeps the Death Stars away.
Yeah.
Which I know a lot of people... It's not a huge deal, but like when you're playing against that Death Star guy, sometimes it gives you that turn to be like, yeah, we're going to chill. And then you can only kill 5 units instead of 6.
I think that's big with the Atropos as well, because you've got the... It gives you a lot more area denial, right? You're shutting down the scout ability from that Death Star. You're shutting down the any infiltrators the other units have.
Calyxuses.
You're shutting down the Calyxus moving up, which isn't huge for this list necessarily, but...
Well, if it assaults your quad mortar battery,
that's not good.
Yeah, it's just gonna.
Inquisitor's not gonna hold up very long.
But the Atropos, because you've got the Vortex, the D Vortex, that's gonna sit on the table. That thing is amazing, and it really doesn't affect your deployment at all, right? So you're moving him up. You've got a turn basically to set him up how you want. And if that Death Star comes towards you, they're slowed down 12 inches compared to what they could be. You're basically just surrounding it with dreadnoughts and slamming it with quad mortars. And then you've got a D-Vortex you're putting on it. You're charging it with D-Weapons and stomps. Like, your Atropos is going to die, but you're going to do a hell of a lot of damage.
Well, that's what this guy said. He was up against the Death Star. He dropped, like, 6 Dreads all around it and charged them all in and did, like, 84 attacks or something like that.
Yeah.
It was, like, because these Blood Angels guys, they get, like, extra attacks.
Oh, yeah, tons of extra
things,
attacks.
Right? So I think he said he had, like, 5 Dreads and was, like, knocking up to, like, 80 attacks.
Yep. Plus, all the Dreadnoughts have 2 more attacks now, right?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that's the only thing. And yeah, if you keep the quad mortars separate, I understand why you might think that would be good to put them on each objective, but I think they're just going to get destroyed.
Yeah, they're long enough range, you can keep them central, especially if you toss them with prescience in them. I think they're going to be way more effective in a single unit.
And like, your flyer build, as I said, might be better. It's just I'm super biased against flyers. I don't like them.
Yeah,
so I don't have much to add on that because it's like my own personal bias. And I have to say, I'm a little bit fanboy of your list because, again, I like Dreadnoughts, I like Armor 13, and I like Drop Pods. So I'm a little bit fanboy biased. So it might be a little bit less effective than we're kind of alluding to, but it's still a very good list.
Yeah, I agree on the flyer. The Stormhawk is good, but it's super fragile. If you're playing with the full Death from the Skies, I don't know if Warzone Atlanta is. Maybe it's something you want to look at. But if you know, it's not a meta where you're using it. Because the other thing you got to keep in mind, right, is with the and this is for you, Chris, with the air superiority detachment, you're either getting +2 to your reserves with that, and -2 to your opponent's reserves, or you're preventing yourself from having -2 to your reserves, which is big.
But he doesn't care in this
list.
He doesn't need it because if these are tactical marines within drop pods, you actually don't want them to come in till turn 5.
Depending on what you're trying to do, but.
But generally,
yeah, I guess
I've lost games because two pods, because I had the Eldar and it's like -1 your reserves, where the guy did rolls terribly, and two pods come in turn 4, and my scatter, I just didn't blow up his, you know what I mean? I just didn't blow it up.
That's actually a really good point. So maybe you almost want to deal with that -2. Yeah. I guess you're probably better off. And the Forge Narrative guys are usually pretty big about playing rules as written, so you'll probably have mysterious objectives too, so... You'll have some sky firing Melta from time to time.
Yeah. I love it. Lucius Pirate drop pawns for the win. Okay, so I hope that we answered all your questions, Jeff, and I hope you're satisfied with that. Please write us back if there's anything that we missed or that you think we're wrong about. And if I can go to Warzone Atlanta, which is a big if, maybe I'll see you there. So we'll move on to questions. So if you're watching us on Twitch, please start typing in your questions into the chat, and we'll try to get to you. We've gotten quite a few. The first one, which is a good one, I'll let Darren take this one away, but I'll read it out, is Rawson emailed us. This is the guy that I mentioned earlier. He sent us an email. And then he's new to 40K, and he would like to know how to approach or get into getting games in a hobby store or in a city, which is perfect for Darren. Like, how do you get games in? And then the second part is there any unwritten etiquette rules? So how do you get games in, Darren, as a new player?
Well, it's difficult. I guess it depends on where you are. I mean, you know, how many game stores you have. It can be daunting as a new player to just go to a store and you know, ask to play somebody, you know, especially if you're not super confident with the rules yet. And as a new player, you probably are not, because there's so many rules. And you don't know what kind of character you're going to come up against at the game store. It's nice if you can run into a gaming club, like, so I, you know, ran into these guys, and that's how I got my first games in, was just playing against people, you know, that you have some kind of link with. And then it's obviously nice if you start with friends or buddies that also want to play, or, you know, that's obviously an easy way to get your first games in. In terms of etiquette, I can honestly say I haven't played at a store since the early 90s. And in those days, there was not much in the way of etiquette. I mean, you just brought whatever you wanted, and, you know, because you didn't know the other person, you know, who, you know, nobody gives, right?
So, yeah.
And I guess that can still happen to some extent. But I guess you shouldn't bring, like, your tournament-winning Death Star to a local game store and challenge a newbie to a game, you know?
Yeah. So, well,
that's a big one.
Yeah,
so,
I think, you know, if you're the person who's introducing or playing a newbie and helping them along, you know, I don't think you should... I'm not saying you should let them win, but it's your responsibility to be an ambassador of the game and to make sure the person sticks around.
Yeah.
And because a new player is so easy, especially if you haven't already spent a lot of money, you haven't invested the time to paint your miniatures yet, to just say, oh, this sucks, I'm bailing, right?
Yeah.
Like, so, and, you know, the hobby always needs more players, and so I think it's the responsibility to try and, you know, foster people along.
Yeah, I think it's important to show up. If you're going to, like, a GW store, because I used to play a little, like, when I first moved out east, Eastern Ontario, I went to GW and Bayshore a little bit. I knew some of them, but it's important to show up, be cool, like, act yourself, be normal, don't, you know, and just ask for a game. And if you don't get a game, you don't, but then keep going back, ask the staff when's a good night, a 40K night. If a store needs you to book a table to have a game, you could pre-book a table alone and then show up and try to get a partner, or advertise on Facebook or a Facebook group that you need somebody to play against. And generally, people will want to play you. There's always somebody looking for a game. Etiquette to me is, this one's, it's hard, but I think you should always have assembled models, or at least mostly assembled, like try to get them to be like maybe a legs and a torso at the very least, if you're really new, and explain that to somebody. I'm really new, I'm trying to build it. It's important too that when you're really new, to maybe show progress that you're interested, and don't touch other people's models. I haven't run into this too much, but some people freak out, and they're usually the weirdos that freak out really easily. But, you know, you should never touch somebody's models without asking permission. And as Darren said, don't bring a net list. Try to, if you're initially trying to get into a group, try to bring something that's fun, and then get in, and then you can start asking. Or if you did bring a net list, there's nothing wrong with saying, hey guys, I'm planning for a tournament, I brought the grossest list imaginable. You're going to get more shit for saying, oh, this list isn't that bad, or whatever, than if you're upfront with somebody, you get very little shit. Like, I've been... Where was I? I was playing a tournament game, and a guy said, wow, your list is filthy. I said, yeah, I came... I think it was Adepticon. I said, yeah, I came here to win. I brought the filthiest list possible. I'm sorry I'm playing you. I said, but I'm going to try my best to win. And the guy was like, oh, you're the first Eldar player that didn't try to tell me that his jet bikes weren't overpowered. I was like, well, they are overpowered, and I'm sorry. I want them to win.
Yeah, but, and that's actually a really good point. So if you're going in, you know, a lot of people might... When I started out playing again, this is something I appreciated, because we had one guy here who was he was that guy, like friendly dude, but he came out to the club to stomp on your face and make sure you had no models left by turn two.
Will Paul,
actually, it wasn't Will Paul, but Will Paul's a great example of that. Anyway, you know, there's a very fine line between trying to be modest about bringing filth and just accepting that you're bringing filth. And it's a lot better to just accept what you're doing than try to rationalize it. So that one game where I was playing against Jamie, right, where I said it was a huge mismatch of lists, the Assault Terminators and everything. It basically ended up with me saying, "Hey, man, this list is pure filth. It is what it is. I'm trying to win with this. I'm sorry the game wasn't very fun, but that's how it is. I'm not going to bring it again because neither of us are going to have a good time." But so as far as getting into the into a local scene, if there's forums, definitely sign up on those. Try to line up a game in advance if you can. Maybe say, hey guys, I'm new to this, or it's my first time out. This is exactly what I did, and it's been fantastic. I went on the forums, and I knew about a local club, and I said, hey, I haven't played Warhammer in, whatever it was, like 10, 12 years, I guess. Looking to get back in. I've got this for my army. Does anybody want to get a game? As long as you don't mind being a little patient with me as we get started. Yeah. And sure enough, I showed up. We played a 4,000-point game, 2v2, and it was a hell of a lot of fun, and I went upstairs and I bought $300 worth of models. And here I am 3 years later.
But I think you'll be fine. Go to a store, be yourself. That's the big thing. And new friendships, new club groups take work, and they take time.
Yep.
And, it might take you a few weeks to get into the group and just shoot the, to shoot the breeze with them and just learn it up, but... That's very important. So
one more quick point on that. The etiquette thing we were talking about, don't touch other people's models. That's
you can big. Touch my models, I don't give
you
a
can
shit.
Touch Chris. You can touch Chris anywhere you want. but now I'm drawing a total blank, man. Hanging around is a great thing to do. As long as you're not like the awkward guy that just sort of sits in the corner being quiet and like scratching incessantly. I don't know. Go make an effort to meet the people that are there, because you're going to have a lot more fun gaming with people or gaming with your friends rather than just showing up and being a stranger every week.
Yeah. But don't be annoying.
Don't be a pest.
The good thing to do at GW stores is show up with a squad of dudes and paint.
Yep.
And then listen to what people are saying and like, oh, these guys are cool, I want to be in that group. Or, this, and just kind of, just if you're always around, then eventually, like, a few days later, you're going to get a game, right? I used to go and paint all the time in GW and White Oaks in London. So, and I'd get games in all the time because you'd have your army there, you'd be painting, so you're not wasting your afternoon, and then, oh yeah, I'll play a game. And it worked really well.
Yep.
But we got to move on. So, why don't more people play Oryx? Which is AOS question, I guess, because of the double R.
Yep.
Lots of people seem to play Oryx on Twitter. I think they seem really popular. Just... The new book's really popular. There's, I think, two of them coming to Capital City. So
yeah, I think it may just be your meta. They're a super cool army. I know a lot of people who spent a lot of money on the new models, especially those Mock Crushes.
They look pretty sweet.
Yeah.
What does an army need to have in order to be competitive?
So I think we actually did a full podcast on this one going back, I think about 20 episodes. Maybe a good one to listen to, but to keep that super quick, cause maybe we'll do a rehash on that one down the road, is there's a whole theory of, there are four phases to the game. You want to make sure you can either excel in all of them, or if you can't excel in all of them, find one phase to just absolutely poop on everyone. And that's, like, from a very basic perspective, that's the best way to find an army that can be competitive.
And OPSEC helps.
OPSEC helps a lot.
it's the best special role in the game.
It is.
Who is the best player? We're not going to answer that. Do you guys want to answer that?
No.
What would you guys do if you want to collect a new army like Death Watch? Buy a starter or wait and see? So maybe this is going for Darren. What would you do if you want to collect a new army?
So if you want to collect a new army, I mean, these boxes are actually all really good values. Mm-hmm. The start collecting boxes. And if you really don't know what models to buy off the bat, because it's a pretty daunting choice, to be honest, and you just want to start playing and figure out what's good and what's not good, then start with the start collecting boxes. Save some money and get some models going. And if you don't like it, well, you haven't spent that much money, you can buy another start collecting box.
Yep.
I know this may not be a popular answer, however, it is fairly cheap to buy even painted models off eBay or Craigslist or Kijiji just to get you started. If you're not sure if you like something, buy somebody's army, and unless they're an artist or they're looking for a lot of, they spend a lot of time on it, you can get these for pretty cheap.
Yep. Secondhand.
And they resell. Yeah, that's
and
the
then
issue.
If you don't like
is
it, then sell it on again, and you probably hadn't lost a lot of money. So, yeah.
Like, even if you buy a fully painted like Space Marine army for $500, you could probably sell it for $480 or $500 if you keep in the same condition, right?
Yeah.
If it's fully painted
nowadays with the secondhand, I mean, in my day it wasn't secondhand because the game had just started. But now, I mean, it's definitely the way to go if you don't want to invest, you know, straight up loads of cash right at the front. You're not sure which one to play yet.
And you know, Darren was talking about the Star Collecting boxes. They are outstanding value. I mean, I think now for the first time in the past 5 or 6 years is probably the cheapest time to actually get into this hobby.
Yeah.
Now, it says here if you want to start a new army, if you're a newer player, I wouldn't recommend Death Watch as a faction to start with. That's just because the only place to get the models right now is in the two fairly expensive Start games. So you're going to have four things. But if you're an advanced player and you want to do it, yeah, I would recommend getting a friend that maybe wants Harlequins and double up. Each of you buy a set and double up, and that's a good way to get into it. Can I make an army only of fortifications?
Until you're using the draft FAQs, yes.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It was FAQ'd, right? It was FAQ'd.
Yep. Thanks for that question. It's a classic.
How can you build an army on a low budget?
So we were just talking about doing secondhand stuff. Yeah. That's probably one of the biggest. There's another question coming up that we're going to talk about, and it's actually from the same person, Rakam, in the chat here, that we'll talk about at the end. But yeah, secondhand is huge. There are also a couple, and this is actually something we mentioned, we talked about at the beginning of the show, is there are a couple armies that are actually very inexpensive to build, inexpensive in Warhammer terms, to build that are really strong lists. Anything Space Wolves, unless you're going like infantry spam, is quite inexpensive. Because I remember we priced this out for ETC, right? You can build a full super competitive Space Wolf army for under $500, including your modeling supplies.
That's retail.
Yeah, that's retail. If you're going to Meeple Mart, you know, you're 20% off that. If you're ordering from Frontline and you're in the U.S., it's even cheaper. If you're buying stuff secondhand, you know, it's trivial. And then there's, you know, all of us are friends in the great socialist republics over east, but
there's some factions that are just very expensive and there's some that are cheap. You just have to kind of do the price point. Like, so if you pick, I want one of these four new armies, put the models in the GW cart and see which one's within your price range, because I have to stress that really matters. If demons, a lot of demon lists are very, very, very expensive. If I need 8 units of flesh hounds, that's $700 for 800 points.
And then you need stuff to summon as well. That's one of the big killers of demons, is you want to have all those extra units you probably wouldn't use otherwise. There are a couple other armies that are great with the Start Collecting boxes, which, you know, as we mentioned, are great value, especially for Age of Sigmar, man. If you want to get into Flesh Eater Courts, oh boy, that box is good value. But the Sakatari one is great as well. You buy two of those, you buy a knight, you've got a war convocation. I guess, and Cataphron Destroyers.
So
it's the same thing. It's like a $450 army.
What's his second question that you said?
How do you feel about placeholders to try things out before you spend Texas with a dollar sign on models? Most people are pretty friendly about proxies. I'm a huge proponent of try before you buy all the time. I do it with everything I can. Find something that's approximately the same size. Just don't abuse people's goodwill about it. Like, don't show up for 2 months proxying a Coke can as a drop pod. You know, maybe do it once, maybe twice. I don't think you'll have any problems with that if that's something you're trying to do. Or just don't do it at tournaments.
Two stacked rhinos as a drop pod, Nick.
I don't see a problem with it at all. It's all done in context. If you're if you and I are, let's say, preparing for CanHammer team tournament and we want to play against all the other lists that are there, we're going to have to proxy.
Yeah,
and it's okay to do.
Exactly.
So it depends on your goals and your motivations. What army should I choose to be the biggest dick possible?
That's from Will Paul. And he wants to know for both systems.
Okay, biggest dick. 40K, I think, would be kind of easy.
Oh, darn.
I don't know. I think the Space Wolf, Ravenwing Death Star is the big dick army. It's one unit. Because I see this like...
Barkstar is taking...
Oh, no, Barkstar maybe. Barkstar is actually less fun to play against.
And so Barkstar is 75 wolves with Azrael with a 4+. Basically, it's a big, giant, stupid unit that can't really be killed, and it's just a game of them running around, killing your shit, and doing nothing. Yeah. At least when you play the Eldar guy, you get to kill some. Like, it's not fun, but you get to kill stuff.
Yeah.
Whereas I think those whole like Death Star armies are they're the dick armies. In Age of Sigmar, the dick army is the least fun I've ever. I shouldn't say that because the guys were great that I played against, but the one that gets the most complaints is the double or triple Hell Cannon Lord of Change type list.
Oh yeah,
that's it's nasty. Not the same under the points, but it's basically just like a ton of mortal wounds that just shoots and stuff like that. So what's the next one? Do you want to take that one, Logan?
Sure. I'm comparing the Medusa Strike Force, the Raven Guard Strike Force, and the Space Wolf non-Death Star armies. Which do you think is best? By the way, I'm definitely using a mini Death Star with a Medusa Strike Force, and if quad mortars don't... so that's two questions. So let's talk about the Medusa Strike Force, Raven Guard Strike Force versus Space Wolves non-Death Stars. I think they're all viable. I think the Raven Guard Strike Force is definitely the dark horse out of those.
Yeah. I think it's really challenging to use.
It's very, very high skill cap, but if you can pull it off, it is incredibly strong.
If you don't,
so that's the one where
you're kind of screwed.
Yeah, that's the other thing. You want to get ways in there to seize. You want to get Kodiaz in there. You want to maybe find a way to get Azreel, just so you can get your plus one to seize with your reroll. I think those are definitely good. The Space Wolves non-Death Star ones are. That's the one where they get like free.
So we're counting like black mains and stuff like that?
Yeah, yeah. They get like, what is it, free drop pods
for
everything?
Yeah, people were all scared about black mains. I don't think it's panned out.
No, I haven't seen anybody running it.
So I used to be a huge nutbag over the 12 drop pod army. It just doesn't work. They just die. Like, you lose to kill point missions. It just doesn't work. Now, Medusa Strike Force, that's the one that's Iron Hands, right?
I believe so.
So the Medusa Strike Force Death Star that he's referring to is one of my favorite ones.
It's really good against...
You basically get the Chapter Master with a 2+ armor save, 2+ feel no pain, and a 3+ invulnerable save.
Yeah.
And he just tanks all the wounds. I love Iron Hands personally. Actually, I did love Iron Hands until I just read a Horus Heresy short story about them. And now I actually loathe them. And don't ever want to play them.
That's why I don't read fluff, man.
Some Iron Hand stuff. They're just the worst chapter ever.
Read fluff. Yeah, the Medusa Strike Force.
It's pretty far up there. It's pretty far up there in the best Death Star.
It's been doing really well. There's a guy down in Toronto who wins a lot of tournaments with it. The only bad matchup I think it has is against a lot of armies that have stomps.
Death Stars though.
Yeah, I mean, it has a hard time against Tau, it has a hard time against Knight armies. It does really well against just about everything else. If you come across, like, a Space Wolf army, like the Space Wolf Star, you might even come out ahead just because neither of them are killing each other. You're just sitting there forever. The only thing I'd warn about that is you are relying very heavily on psychic powers to make that list really viable, so you want to have your Lib Conclave. I think that list in particular needs Veil of Time to be super effective, so you can get that 3+ reroll and Vol save. You're taking Storm Shields and Power Fists on your veterans as well, so you got to keep them alive because they're really, really expensive models with only one wound.
Yeah, it's up to you. I think you would benefit, depending on the level of player that you are, the Raven Guard Strike Force would give you an edge that people wouldn't really see coming, and you could do a lot of reserve manipulation and a lot of really tricksy stuff, but you're going to have to take it that you're going to lose probably a bunch of games.
Yeah.
But it's pretty solid. So, yep. And the second part is, if quad mortars don't need line of sight, what about using the armored containers to hide behind? I think the barrels of the gun might be taller than the armored containers, but if they're not, that'd be an excellent idea.
Yeah, they're good for it. I think they are smaller.
You can stack them too, the armored containers.
Yeah, you can stack the containers. The question around that comes, do you want to spend the 40 or 80 points for it, or do you want to just take the 55-point tech marine and give yourself 3+ cover save somewhere?
That's a tough one.
It depends. So we had this conversation, I think, when we were talking about demons and... do you take a Bastion or do you just rely on the tables? You know, for the Du Bois versus the
That's
OBO
not the
thing.
Same, though. That's not the same, because if you go second you either have to put Kairos in reserve or he dies.
Well, yes, but what I'm saying is if you know you're going to an event that has a ton of line of sight blocking terrain, the crates do a lot less for you because none of those things, like the 4+ invul benefits you, but the other rolls are sort of inconsequential. The ammo dumps and the Promethean relays do nothing for you.
And our artillery doesn't need it because of the toughness 7, the tech marine tanking, plus the bolstering terrain. I don't think the artillery needs it. I think what the softer stuff benefits from the crates a lot more.
Yep.
And that's about it, right? Any other questions from the chat?
We got one quick one, which is, we don't need to answer this, but how do you choose a commission painter? What do you look for and what do you avoid? So we'll leave this one to Darren and feel free to...
Well, I'll just give my answer really quick. Okay. I only play with models that I paint because that's just some stupid rule that I made up. So
all right.
I don't do it.
So for the guy who has worked with multiple commission painters, what do you look for?
Yeah, you want reputation, obviously.
Yep.
You want, obviously, the quality that you're looking for. And it can be very hard to tell from pictures.
Yeah.
And obviously the pictures are their best work of all time. Local is nice, because then you take out all the shipping and stuff, but for a guy who had a bunch of stuff painted in Australia, if you're willing to pay and you have good painter, then, yeah, you should avoid people who don't answer your emails within 24 hours.
Yep.
Because I think not serious about it.
I think that's good advice for any business, not just commission painting.
Yeah.
Well, that's a good point, though, when you're saying, like, their photos are their best work ever. It's like you can tell, like, all the girls that their Facebook photos are from a high end. You know what I mean? Everybody puts their best photo. So take that with a grain of salt and just make sure you get what you want and speak up early, right? Before.
Yeah, and then have it written somewhere exactly what it is that you want and what you've agreed to do
and when it should be sent to you. Is that ever a problem that people take way longer or
so
this wasn't intentional. That wasn't intentional.
Darren's laughing because we were about 2 months late delivering our commission to him. To my understanding, and you can correct me if I'm wrong on this, 2 months late is actually still faster than most studios deliver. So if you can find a studio that delivers on time or has a reputation for delivering on time, that's huge. I know a lot of the bigger studios, Blue Table Painting, had a huge fiasco about this last year, right? They under-delivered and delivered late for a project they were doing, like a multi-$1,000 project. And I'm sure they've gotten everything sorted out now, just in terms of their business stuff. This isn't a knock at them, but it's a good case study, and it is a lot of commission studios are infamous for delivering much, much later than promised. And unfortunately, we fell into that as well. It's really tough.
Since we're an Ontario-based podcast, if you're in Ontario, there is two commission painters that are quite excellent. One is a friend of ours, Dan. So if you want Dan's information, he does really good work. You can email us, canhammer.podcast@gmail.com. The other one is Max from Quebec City.
Yep,
he has a what's his company called again?
Hellfire Painting.
Hellfire Painting. He's on. He posts a lot on Spiky Bits. But if you want to get in touch with him, you can also email us, and I'll forward your info to him. Both are very reliable and somewhat local, right? London. It's Dan's in London, and then Max is in Quebec City, and they both take commissions.
And both those guys routinely win Best Painted Awards at massive events. They are extremely talented artists.
And I want to say Dan's pretty quick turnaround time from what I've seen, because I've seen him do commission work, and like it's done. He's like, oh, look what I got this commission the other day, and it's done already and gone, right? So I guess that's everything. Anything else to add or questions?
That is all we've got.
Okay, so I guess that's it for it. Thanks for listening, guys. For any feedback, you can email us, canhammer.podcast@gmail.com. You can visit www.oneplusarmor.com for more information. Darren has two battle reports going live on YouTube for the OnePlus channel, correct?
Yes, they're coming up.
So stay tuned for those if you want more information from him. And so thanks for coming on, Darren, and joining us.
Thanks for having me.
No problems. Have a good one.